wonder who is the source when it came to the Islamic as well as modern day sciences? Who was seen as the colossus of Islamic knowledge? The life of which individuals offers many lessons in jurisprudence, theology, ethics, and philosophy? To find out, Sayid Hussein Al-Qazwini is joining us tonight to shed some light upon the life of our fifth Imam, seventh infallible Imam Muhammad Al-Baqir, peace and blessings be upon him. Respected viewers, my dear guests, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to tonight's episode as we rejoice and celebrate the birth anniversary of Imam Muhammad Al-Baqir. So for this reason, I would like to congratulate you as well as congratulate Imam Sahib Al-Asri wa Zaman. May Allah hasten his reappearance, the Ahlul Bayt and our pious scholars on this very auspicious occasion. As I mentioned, Sayyid Hussein Al-Qazwini is joining us tonight. So, assalamu alaikum, Sayyidina.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
Allah khalikum, inshallah. How are you?
Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. I would like to congratulate you on this very auspicious occasion.
Likewise.
Allah yasalimkum, inshallah. Now, Imam Al-Baqir, alayhi salam, if one was to analyze his life, unfortunately, it has been understudied in various aspects. One of the aspects, I don't want to go deep into this, but whenever Imam Al-Baqir is mentioned, his father or his son is mentioned. When you say Imam Al-Baqir, they always talk about Imam Al-Sajjad. When you say Imam Al-Baqir, they always talk about Imam Al-Sadiq alayhi salam. They don't give so much credit to this individual, although he offered so much, as inshallah we'll get to touch upon in these upcoming nights, inshallah. Now, to begin it off, we see that the crystallization of Islamic knowledge and the Islamic wisdom, if you will, occurred during the time of Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam. Before we get into that even, how is Imam Al-Baqir seen in the viewpoint of Sunni scholars? What do they say about him?
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله.
My dear viewers, something that I saw a couple of days ago, not on Imam Al-Baqir, but on Imam Musa ibn Ja'far,
yes,
Al-Kadhim. I saw a tweet by Al-Azhar.
Well, in Egypt.
Yeah. Al-Azhar University. They have a Twitter account. I saw a tweet by them. They usually tweet about some of the Sahaba, some of the Tabi'een, and famous Muslim figures in history. They tweeted about Imam Musa ibn Ja'far, which was strange.
Yeah.
It was good. But they defined him as such. Min ruwat al-hadith,
wow.
Musa ibn Ja'far. They define him as a narrator, as one of the narrators of hadith. And that very much offended me, that the way they saw Imam Musa ibn Ja'far as a regular narrator. Now, some might see al-Imam al-Baqir, of course not followers of Ahlul Bayt. We followers of Ahlul Bayt, we see Imam al-Baqir as an infallible Imam, who has the right, who has the authority to legislate laws.
Yes.
In fact, his name, Baqir, comes from Baqir al-Ilm. He split through knowledge.
Yeah.
And spread knowledge, so on and so forth. But how do the others view him? We might know Imam al-Baqir, but others don't know Imam. Others might not know Imam al-Baqir, and even us, even his followers, how much do we know about Imam al-Baqir? As you said, if we talk about Imam al-Baqir, we either talk about his father or his son. We rarely give him attention. So I thought, you know, what do others
think
about Imam al-Baqir? What have others said about Imam al-Baqir? Was he someone that was
random
person, not known, or, you know, people knew his value? So, for example, we see that he had a lot of respect. He was recognized. He was recognized for his knowledge, for his wisdom, for his patience, for his acts of worship. He was known as a special character, but unfortunately, they don't call him an imam. They recognize his qualities as an imam, but they don't call him an imam. For example, In Bihar al-Anwar, al-A'lam al-Majlisi, volume 11, page 82, he narrates from Abdullah ibn Ata al-Makki.
Yeah.
This is a well-known Sunni figure. He says, ما رأيت العلماء عند أحد قط أصغر منهم أصغر منهم عند أبي جعفر محمد ibn Ali al-Husayn. He says, I haven't seen scholars shrink as midgets, not physically.
Yeah.
But
mentally,
intellectually, they become midgets in the presence of anyone. Like I saw them become midgets in the presence of Imam Al-Baqir. In the presence of Imam Al-Baqir, a top scholar will seem as a preliminary student.
Wow.
Who has recently entered school. And he says, وَلَقَدْ رَأَيْتُ الْحَكَمْ إِبْنِ عُتَيْبَ مَعَ جَلَالَتِي فِي الْقَوْمِ بين يديه كأنه صبي بين يدي معلمه. He says, I saw Al-Muhakkam ibn Utaybah, who's a big scholar, like a small child in the presence of Al-Imam Al-Baqir. This is one incident. In another case, Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, the famous Umayyad Khalifa, he asked the governor of Medina. Abdul Malik ibn Marwan is in Damascus, he's in Sham. He asked the governor of Medina to send him Al-Imam Al-Baqir
shackled,
with his hands tied and in a disgraceful manner. Mm-hmm. His governor, he wrote him, he told him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, he calls him Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen.
Yeah.
I don't mean to disrespect you, nor do I mean to disobey you, but I have to advise you that the one that you're asking me to send with his hands tied, this person is the most noble person on earth, and there is no one as humble and as pious and as righteous and as knowledgeable as him.
Wow.
And I haven't seen anyone kinder than him, anyone with acts of worship better than him. So I would hate for people to say that such a person, you dragged him to Damascus with his hand tied. This was the governor of Medina to the governor that was appointed by Bani Umayyah.
Mm-hmm. Makes you wonder, I mean, such individuals, when they do recognize how great this individual is,
right.
yet they persecute them, they do various... Yeah.
Wow. Hisham ibn Abd al-Malik. Hisham ibn Abd al-Malik is also one of the
rulers.
Khulafa ibn Umayyah. He says, Wallah ma jarrabtu alayka kithba. He tells him, I never caught you with a lie. Never. I never caught you with a lie. Ibn Abil Hadid al-Mu'tazili. The one who explained Nahj al-Balagha. He's Sunni. He's a Mu'tazili. He's not from the Ahlul Bayt. He's not a follower of Ahlul Bayt. He has nothing to do with Ahlul Bayt. But look at what he says. كان محمد بن علي بن الحسين Imam Baqir سيد فقهاء الحجاز ومنه ومن ابنه جعفر تعلم الناس الفقه. He was the master of the jurists of Hijaz, meaning the Arabian Peninsula. And it was because of him and his son Ja'far that people learned fiqh. You know, there's a saying in Arabic that says, "Wal-fadl ma shahada bihi al-a'da'u," that true virtue is said by the mouth of your enemy. When your friend praises you, you know, that's he could friend, be, he might be flattering you. But when your enemy praises you, that's real praise.
Yeah.
There's no flattery. He's not trying to flatter you. He's saying the truth. Right? Of course, Ibn Abil Hadid was not an enemy of Ahlul Bayt, but he was definitely not one of the followers. Ibn Khalakan.
Mm-hmm.
Ibn Khalakan is a well-known scholar, and he has a book called Wafayat al-A'yan. It's a book of biographies of al-A'yan, famous people in history. He talks about Imam al-Baqir, and he says Abu Ja'far, Muhammad ibn Ali, Zain al-Abidin, Ibn al-Husayn, Ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib, radiyallahu anhum ajma'in, al-mulaqab bil-Baqir. He mentions his name, his full lineage, and he says his title is Al-Baqir.
أحد الأئمة الاثنى عشر وكان الباقر عالما سيدا كبيرا.
He says he's one of the 12 Imams for the Shia, and Al-Baqir was a scholar, Sayyidan, Kabiran. He was a great person.
Mm-hmm.
He was a great person. This is in Wafayat al-A'yan, volume 3, page 314.
Greater than this is what Ibn Hajar. Ibn Hajar is a staunch enemy of the Shia.
Yeah.
He calls us Rawafid. He doesn't even call us Shia. A staunch enemy of the Ahl Bayt. In his book, الصواعق المحرقة. Wow. الصواعق المحرقة في الرد على, I believe, الروافض وأهل الزندقة.
Wow.
يعني he wrote his book as an anti-Shia book.
Wow.
In this book, he talks about Imam al-Baqir, وارثه أي وارث الإمام زين العابدين منهم, عبادة وعلما وزهادة أبو جعفر محمد الباقر.
Wow.
His the heir of Imam Zain al-Abidin with knowledge, the heir of his knowledge, the heir of his worship, the heir of his asceticism is Muhammad al-Baqir. And he was called Baqir min Baqir al-Ard, ay shakkaha wa athara makhba'ataha wa makaminaha. He's saying why he was called Imam al-Baqir. فذلك هو أظهر من مخبأات كنوز المعارف وحقائق الأحكام والحكم واللطائف. He keeps on talking about his virtues.
Of virtues.
He talks about the virtues of Imam al-Baqir, about his knowledge, about his wisdom, about his acts of worship. This is an enemy of Ahl al-Bayt. Mm-hmm. This is an enemy of the Shia. And he praises Imam al-Baqir to this way.
Mm-hmm. I mean, especially the Ahl Bayt and especially Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam, even their enemies have to testify to their knowledge and to their devotion to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Absolutely.
I mean, just to add upon your point, I can't remember which book it was written in, but it was another Sunni source where Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari, who Prophet Muhammad told him, you're going to meet the fifth descendant from my family, which is Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam.
Ahsant.
And you'll get to see his knowledge and stuff. I mean, he was very old, and it's mentioned that the fifth descendant of Prophet Muhammad, and it's unfortunate. Even the rulers knew that the fifth descendant was the truly rightful Imam. And of course they knew. But the fact is, you know, some individuals have their personal agenda and so on and so forth. But there are various other narrations in regards to Al-Baqir alayhi salam. I can't remember specifically, but if you would like to shed some light upon that, that would be great.
Narrations
regarding how Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam, I mean, for example, one of the narrations really give us the tolerance of the Imam through his actions when someone called him Baqar, meaning in the Quran we have Surah al-Baqarah,
right,
meaning the chapter of the cow,
right,
and he came up to the Imam, called him a cow. Now the Imam, any individual now, either they would get offended and keep quiet, or they would, you know, be act impulsively towards that individual.
Ahsant.
Yet the Imam was tolerant in that situation.
Right. Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam was known for several qualities,
mm-hmm,
and tolerance was one of them.
Mm-hmm.
He was known for his tolerance, for his patience, for his piety, for his generosity, for his worship,
mm-hmm,
for so many.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when we talk about his tolerance, you're right. This is a famous story. It's mentioned in several sources. In Manaqib al-Abi Talib by Shah Rashub, in Bihar al-Anwar, al-Anwar al-Bahiyya, Mustadrak al-Bihar. Several sources mention the story. That a man from... he was a Christian.
Mm-hmm.
He was a Christian man, kitabiyan. He saw Imam al-Baqir, and he heard of him. He came and he called him a cow. Anta baqar. Baqar in Arabic means cow. Imam al-Baqir remained quiet, remained silent. He didn't return, if it's us, regular human beings, when we're insulted, we return one insult with
double.
You know, not just double, 16 other insults. We don't keep quiet. That's part of human nature, that you become defensive.
Yeah.
But Ahlul Bayt really taught us akhlaq, really taught us akhlaq, that you control your anger, you don't return the insult. Here you discover people's akhlaq.
Definitely.
Not by saying, I am this, I am that, do this, do that. Right now I could sit behind the screen now and tell people, do this and do that. It doesn't show my akhlaq.
It doesn't.
I'm just preaching. It shows my akhlaq when I start implementing what I preach.
Of course, definitely.
Imam Al-Baqir and all the imams, you see their akhlaq from how they behaved, not what they said. Now people forget what you say, but they'll never forget what you did. So he called the imam and he told him, "Anta Baqar."
Wow.
You're a cow. Imam Al-Baqir, he remained quiet and very calmly, he said, "No. Ana Baqir. Ana Baqir. Not Baqar." Basically,
he corrected him.
He corrected him. And he's giving him the benefit of the doubt. That perhaps, you know, you didn't pronounce my name correctly. Yeah. I'm not Baqar. I'm Baqir. He gave him the benefit of the doubt. The imam, the Christian man, he continued. He said, "Anta ibn al-tabakha."
Wow.
You're the son of the cook, female cook. Your mother was a cook. You know, as if that's a...
an insult.
As an insult. So what? It's a profession. It's a job. He was trying to insult the imam. The imam was not insulted. He said, "Dhaki harfatuha." That's her profession. That's not an insult.
Mm-hmm.
Is she committing a crime? Is she committing a sin? Is she killing anyone? No. "Dhaki harfatuha." You're not insulting her by saying that. Apparently, he was trying to, you know, instigate. He was trying to get the imam to get angry.
Yeah.
But nothing was working. He called him a cow. Didn't work. He told him, "Your mother is a cook." That didn't count. No. He
went at him again.
I'm sorry?
He went at him again.
He went at him again, and he went on a step further. He said, "Anta ibn al-Sawda al-Zanjiya al-Badhi'a."
Wow.
You're the son of the black... you know, in English, we call it the N-word.
Yeah.
Zanjiya.
That to be
it's
racist.
A translation of the N-word in English. So you're the son of the black female. And he said the N-word, basically. Al-Badhi'a. Badhi'a is it's translated as, you know, someone that pushes you off because of their looks, because of their... maybe ugly. It's not exactly ugly, but it's something repulsive.
Yeah. Wow.
That your mother was a black female, N-word, and she was repulsive. Very, very cruel. Very cruel.
If that was us, wow.
Imagine someone that speaks about your mom. No one takes that. No one is more special to us than our mothers.
Wow.
Right? If there was anyone else, they would have gotten up, not just return the insults, but even
kill him.
Beat him.
Yeah.
Maybe kill him. Maybe physically hurt him.
Yeah.
Imam taught us a lesson. He said, "If you are right, then may Allah forgive her. If she was repulsive, if you are right, may Allah forgive her.
Wow.
And if you're wrong, may Allah forgive you." Khalas. That was it.
Come on.
He didn't tell him, "You know what? I'm going to kill you. You better watch your mouth. I'm going to send a gang to do this." If you are right, may Allah forgive her. If you are wrong, may Allah forgive you. Such a beautiful lesson. Such a beautiful lesson that we could take home. And then the narration says that the man became a Muslim.
Wow.
After seeing this akhlaq from Imam Al-Baqir, he became a Muslim. Shouldn't we learn this? Shouldn't we learn this lesson from the Imam? How many times do we get insulted?
Oh, yeah.
Especially on social media. You know, people on social media, you might see them in person, they're cowards.
Yeah.
But on social media, they become Rambo. They think they could say whatever they want, do whatever they want. They could make any comment. You know, there might be presidents, top religious leaders. They'll go on their accounts and they'll make, you know, offensive remarks. They think they're brave.
Yeah.
They're not brave. You're sitting on the phone. If you're really brave, you'll come in, you know, insult the person to their face. Anyhow, but it has its effect. When you're insulted, you want to return the insult. And so on and so forth. It really happens
online. You see it on Twitter, on Facebook, on Instagram, on social media.
Yeah.
How beautiful would it be if we'd learn from the Imam?
Oh, yeah.
That if what you're saying is true about me, may Allah forgive me. If what you're saying is not true, may Allah forgive you. What a beautiful, beautiful way to reply.
And that's, I mean, that's an embodiment of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَالَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى أَرْضِ هَوْنًا. And those who walk humbly on earth,
وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا.
When the ignorant address them, they say the words of peace. And Imam Al-Baqir put it beautifully in his action. But we'll continue the discussion, but after a short break.
Inshallah.
So respected viewers, do stay tuned. For after the break, we'll inshallah continue our discussion revolving around the qualities, characteristics, and merits of Imam Muhammad Al-Baqir. Respected viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to the second part of today's episode. Now, before the break, we did touch upon the viewpoints of various scholars of various faiths. What have they stated about Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam? And we got to the point of talking about his characteristics and qualities. This was discussed with my dear guest, Sayid Hussein Al-Qazwini. Welcome back, Sayyidina.
Thank you very much.
Allah salimkum. Now, before the break, we did touch upon his tolerance. And we touched upon to what extent does an individual have tolerance, I mean forbearance, for Imam Al-Baqir to be insulted in a way, and you know, insulting the mother, as we mentioned, something very, you know, very hard to hear and to bear. Yet Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam took it in and showed the opposite. He showed a peaceful response, if you will. Now, for patience, we find Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam being patient in various times. I mean, even from he was little up until his old age, although he, you know, for example, when they said they want him to bring him and, you know, they want to cuff him. When Al-Hajjaj Musa Thaqafi was in Medina, he also persecuted the Imam, yet he was patient. To what extent was he patient?
First of all, we have to put things into perspective and know the context of what was happening during the days of Imam Al-Baqir. Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam, he succeeded Imam Zain al-Abidin. Imam Zain al-Abidin, you know, he came after
Imam Hussein
and the day of Ashura. These were very difficult times for the Ahlul Bayt during Bani Umayyah's time. The Imams were not only kept out of power, but they were persecuted. Their followers were persecuted. There were spies checking on the Imams, who enters their house, who leaves their house, who do they meet with. Very strict conditions, very tight conditions. They didn't have freedom to go wherever they'd like. No, they were kept under control. This is one. Two, Imam Zain al-Abidin and Imam al-Baqir were living at a time when the official state, it was one of their policies was to curse Ali ibn Abi Talib, Fatima al-Zahra, and al-Hasan al-Husayn.
this would happen every Friday in the Friday sermon, Khutbah al-Jum'ah. Imam Al-Baqir was right there in the city. He could hear. He could hear his father's, his grandfather, his father being cursed. His grandmother, Fatima Zahra, being cursed. This is not easy. This requires a lot of patience.
Yeah.
To see, to being cursed and to have your fathers and grandfathers being cursed. Many of their companions were persecuted. Some of them were killed. Some of them were jailed. Kenny, it's like living in Iraq during Saddam's time.
Yeah.
Imagine how difficult it was. Imagine how difficult it was. It's the same conditions. Bani al-Umayyah, Saddam, they're all...
linked in a way.
Yeah, they're all linked, and their faces to the, you know, same coin, but different faces.
Yeah.
Right? Imam al-Baqir was patient. He was very political. He was very diplomatic. He knew how to keep Shi'ism alive, to save Shi'ism, to save the Shia. And that required a lot of patience.
Mm-hmm.
This is, you know, for general, the general situation.
Mm-hmm.
When we come to specific details in his life, we see that Imam al-Baqir was very patient. One narration states that one day, Imam al-Baqir was sitting with a group of his companions. One of the workers at his house, he came and he whispered something in his ear. Imam al-Baqir, he nodded, and then he said, Alhamdulillah ala ma a'ta, wa lahu ma akhadh. Thanks to Allah for everything that he's given, and thanks for everything that he's taken. Tell them not to cry. Take him and prepare him for burial. And ask them to be calm. And tell the female slave, don't worry, do not be afraid, and you are free for the sake of Allah because you were frightened. People said, what's going on?
Yeah.
Thanks to Allah for what he has given, for what he has taken. Do not cry. Go prepare him for burial. What is going on?
Yeah.
So they asked the one sitting, Imam al-Baqir, maybe he was busy talking or he got up. So they asked the worker or the servant of the Imam. They told him, what's happening? He said one of the female slaves inside the house of Imam al-Baqir was carrying his son, one of his sons. She dropped him and he died. So he said, Alhamdulillah, for what he's given and for what he has taken. Tell them not to cry. Tell them remain calm.
Wow.
And tell that female slave she's free. We're not going to punish her. Not only we're not going to punish her, we're going to set her free. This was his patience. This was his akhlaq.
However,
his son just died. His son just died and he's calm. He's calm. Khalas. He leaves everything in the hands of Allah. I just want to mention one thing about having slaves. Because one of the Imam's attributes, one of his qualities was that he would free slaves as much as he can. Some might think, well, the Ahlul Bayt had slaves? Yes. Because it was something very common.
Yeah.
It was something very common in every household to have slaves. So I don't want my dear viewers
was
to think...
Was it in the same manner as everyone workers. Else would have a slave?
I'm sorry?
Was it in the same manner that everyone other than, you know... The
everyone
others
had slaves. Everyone had
no,
slaves.
No, but did they treat them the same manner
no,
as everyone?
No. Of course not. First of all, Imam al-Baqir, he treated his slaves like his own children. This is one. Not just Imam al-Baqir, but all the Imams. The ones who had servants and slaves at home, they treated them like their own children. They educated them, they fed them, they took care of them, and they would free them all the time. They would buy slaves, educate them, and free them. Because that was one of the ways that Ahlul Bayt could spread Islam. They couldn't openly have universities, they couldn't openly have classrooms. They did it through slaves. They would buy the slaves, educate them, take care of them. They were called slaves, but they were like children of the Imam at home. They would educate them, and then they would set them free and tell them, go and spread Islam. So I don't want people to think that, well, how could Ahlul Bayt have slaves? This was something very normal.
Yes.
It was something very normal that everyone had slaves at the time. So it wasn't like a taboo. But the Ahlul Bayt would free slaves. They would buy them and free them, buy them and free them. Why buy them? Because if they remain someone else's property, mm-hmm. they will never be freed. So they buy them, educate them, and free them.
Wow.
Anyhow, in another instance, Imam Al-Baqir, historians say, had a son that he really loved. He was young, he really loved him, and he became ill. Imam Al-Baqir was very worried about him. He would come and visit him until finally the son died. When the son died, Imam Al-Baqir was at ease. Khalas. He surrendered to Allah. They were afraid to tell him. But when they told him, they saw that the Imam is at ease. He said, yes, I was worried about him, but now that he's dead, I surrender to Allah. Wow. This is the will of Allah. He decided to take him. Khalas. He said, "Inna nad'u Allah fima yuhib." We ask Allah to do what He wants. طيب. فإذا وقع ما نكره. No, this is, should be فيما نحب. إنا ندعو الله فيما نحب. We ask Allah to do that which we want. Now, there's a typo here. That which we want, we ask Allah to do. Meaning, in this case, I ask Allah to cure my son. فإذا وقع ما نكره. But if what actually happens is something that we hate, لم نخالف الله فيما يحب.
Wow.
We will not disobey Him in that which He wants. We want something. But if what happens is not that what we want, khalas, that means that's what Allah wants.
Just a bit earlier, you did mention something regarding how generous the Imam was when you mentioned freeing the slaves. In a way, generosity is not always giving money. In a sort of way where you mentioned the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, specifically Imam Al-Baqir, would used to buy the slaves and then free them after educating them.
Right.
Now, in a sort of way, Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam was an individual who did not push back anyone that approached him. You know, for example, today when someone approaches us and they're in need of money, we tend to either push them away or say that we don't have any of that to give you. You know what I mean? How did the Imam treat such individuals?
First of all, regarding slaves, historians say that he would continuously free slaves. And once he had a family of 11 members that worked at his house, they were slaves. He freed them all at once.
Wow.
He freed them all at once. And right before his death, he had 60 slaves, and he freed 2/3 of them. Meaning he freed 40 of them, and he kept 20. He kept 20 maybe for Imam Sadiq and for the service of Imam Sadiq. But he continuously freed slaves. This was compassion. This was an Islamic attribute. فَكُّ رَقَبَةً عِتْقُ رَقَبَةً. The Quran encourages, free your slaves. And Imam Al-Baqir did that. Among his qualities was that he would never turn anyone down. Whoever would come to the house of Imam Al-Baqir for a debt, for a loan, for a grant, Imam Al-Baqir would give. In fact, it was something that he took pride in, to help those that were around him, surrounding him, meaning friends, followers, some of the Shia, students. He supported them. In fact, he would tell his son Imam Sadiq. Imam Sadiq had thousands of students. Imam Al-Baqir told him that give money to your students. They're students of knowledge. They're seekers of knowledge. If you don't pay them, they're going to have to go to work and they will not be able to seek knowledge. So give them money. Give them money just enough for them to make a living so that they don't need to go to work, so that they could devote themselves to seeking knowledge full time. This is generosity, to think of others, to think of helping others. In Medina, they say that Imam Al-Baqir, most of his donations went to the people of Medina. In one narration, in Sharh Shafiyat Abi Firas, volume 2, page 176, that Imam Al-Baqir spent on the people of Medina 18,000 dinars. 18,000 dinars was huge. You would buy mansions, mansions, huge mansions with this amount of money on the people of Medina, especially on Fridays. Imam Al-Baqir, on Fridays, he would spend more than any other day. And he was known to say, As-sadaqatu yawm al-jum'ah tudha'ifu al-fadl ala ghayrih.
Wow.
Ala ghayrihi min al-ayyam. Giving charity and giving money to the poor on Friday is more valuable than giving money to the poor mm-hmm. on any other day. Mm-hmm. So Friday was his best day of giving. Mm-hmm. One day, one of his followers, he came and he complained to Imam Al-Baqir that I don't make enough income, and my expenses are more than my income, and my friends don't help. And he was complaining. He wasn't asking.
He
was just complaining to the Imam. Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam told him, indeed, a friend, you want a friend at times of need. As the saying goes, a friend in need is a friend in need. When at times when you're in need and this person sticks to you, and he's really your friend. And then the Imam says, you know, some people, they only know you when you're rich.
Yeah.
But when you're poor, they don't leave you. You know, he was trying to sympathize.
Yeah.
He was trying to sympathize. And then he asked his servant to bring him a bag, a small bag. The bag had 700 dirhams. Oh. He gave it to the man. He said, take this as a gift for me. And if it ever finishes, Come back to me and tell me. Other narrations say that his brothers, as in followers, not his biological brothers,
mm-hmm.
if they would come to his house, they would not leave his house hungry, meaning he would always put food in front of them. They would not leave the house without proper clothing. He would bring them clothing. You know, you bring food to your guests. Oh, we haven't heard of anyone that brings clothing. Spoils his guests. And he gives them money. And he would be proud. He says, one of the things that I enjoy in this life is to do good deeds like this. This is one of my hobbies in life, is to help my brothers mm-hmm. and to give them. You know, some people, their hobbies to travel, to visit every country out there, to visit all the beaches and all the countries with beautiful sights. Everyone has a hobby.
Yeah.
Imam Al-Baqir's hobby is to help people.
Wow.
He says, I love life because I get to help others. Beautiful. This is beautiful. People say, I hate life. You know, life is evil. No. Imam Al-Baqir, on the contrary, he says, if life allows me to help people, life is good.
Yeah.
Life is good. This life is meaningful. I don't hate it. Because I'm taking advantage of life to help people,
mm-hmm.
to provide support.
Mm-hmm. I mean, and one of the things that really touch the heart in the life of Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam, as you mentioned, is the way that he treated everybody. But yet we find the other imams, you know, on the contrary, like Ali ibn Talib alayhi salam, who, you know, used to not spend, yet we find Imam Al-Baqir spending.
Mm.
Isn't that contrary to this?
No. See, Imam Ali alayhi salam, first of all, each imam had a special quality.
Mm-hmm.
Each imam symbolized a special quality. They completed one another.
Mm-hmm.
This is one of the beautiful things about the Ahlul Bayt. They completed one another. For example, Imam al-Hasan al-Mujtaba, known for his generosity, right? Imam al-Sadiq, known for his knowledge. Does that mean that Imam al-Sadiq was not generous and Imam al-Hasan was not knowledgeable? No. Imam al-Hasan was just as knowledgeable as Imam al-Sadiq, if not more.
Mm-hmm.
Imam al-Sadiq was just as generous as Imam al-Hasan, but they completed each other. They took on different roles to symbolize different qualities. To mortalize, Imam Zain al-Abidin is known as Zain al-Abidin. What, the other imams didn't worship?
Yeah.
No, but Imam Zain al-Abidin, he took on this symbol. so that it becomes an example for others.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't mean that Imam Ali did not spend or he wasn't generous, but Imam Ali's circumstances were different. Imam Ali was in power.
Mm-hmm.
In power, you have to not spend, or spend less, not spend lavishly.
Mm-hmm.
Spending is a quality when you're not is a good quality when you're not in power, but when you're in power, no.
You have to
spend less, yeah. Because this is not your money. It's other people's money.
Mm-hmm. You have to employ
it's other people's quality. Money. So Imam Ali, in power, he didn't have lavish spending. Nothing. He didn't spend on himself because it's Muslims' money.
Yeah.
He had to be very careful mm-hmm. with it. But at the same time, at night, Imam Ali alayhi salam, he would, you know, go under disguise. He would wrap his head. People would not recognize him. And he would go door to door. Give, take bread, take clothing, take food from door to door.
Wow.
So you see this quality, you know, in the life of Imam Ali as well, but maybe in the life of Imam Baqir it was more so.
Mm-hmm.
They complete one another.
Okay.
The roles completed each other.
It's good that we clarified that.
Right.
We do have a couple of minutes, and also what is related to tolerance and to patience. Is the aspect of worship, you know, because if an individual is patient, it really makes him grow. And when an individual grows, he gets connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a better way. If you can talk about the worship of Imam Al-Baqir just within a couple of minutes.
Sure. I might not get a chance to finish,
mm-hmm.
but we could give some aspects. Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam, narrators say that when he would stand to pray, his face would turn pale. His face would turn pale, out of fear of Allah Azza wa Jalla, out of, you know, due to his concentration. You know, when you go visit someone important, you're nervous, right? If we're told that we're gonna visit one of the top maraja, or the president, or a king. You'd get nervous.
Yeah.
You're visiting someone very important. But when it comes to our salah, we could care less. Imam Al-Baqir was the opposite. He wouldn't care to meet a president or a king. But when it was time to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because salah is what? Salah is standing in the presence of Allah. It's speaking to Allah. The imam would get nervous. The imam, he's an infallible imam, he would get nervous.
Wow.
At times of salah. As for us, SubhanAllah, our salah, I don't know, will Allah accept it, not accept it? We don't even know what we're saying. We don't pay attention. We don't concentrate. That is why, you know, we make so many mistakes in our salah. Not on purpose. Not that we don't know how to pray.
Yeah.
Because our mind is somewhere else. All of a sudden, I don't know. Am I in the third rak'ah or am I in the fourth?
Wow.
Or am I in the fifth? Because we don't pay attention.
Yeah.
If we thought of salah as standing in the presence of Allah. Right now, Allah is listening to me. Allah is listening to what I'm saying. We would take it more seriously. We would concentrate in salah.
Yeah.
But when we don't realize what our salah means, we don't realize that Allah is watching and He's hearing.
Yeah.
Then we take it lightly. Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam would get nervous. He would get nervous. And according to some narrations, that Imam Al-Baqir would pray, and aside to the wajib prayers, the mandatory prayers, he would pray 150 rak'ah every day.
Wow.
He would offer prayers. You know, when I think of our lives, we barely do the wajib prayer. The mandatory prayer,
we barely do it.
We barely do it. At 17 units, it's like a burden on our shoulders that we want to get rid of. Salatul Dhuhr, we'll pray it quickly just to get rid of it. Salat al-Asr, Salat al-Maghrib, to pray extra prayers?
Wow.
That is almost impossible.
Impossible.
Imam Al-Baqir would pray 150 rak'ahs extra
mm-hmm.
to offer. What a big difference between him and us.
And us. Hopefully, inshallah, we can, you know, get to learn more about his life, that we can actually take him as a role model. I would like to thank you very much for joining us tonight. We will, inshallah, continue our discussion tomorrow, also revolving on the life of Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam. Once again, I do thank you for joining us tonight. Respected viewers, thank you very much for joining us tonight. Hopefully we can learn from the life of Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam, how to become individuals who are tolerant, who are patient, who are generous, and who devoutly worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thank you very much once again. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.